Hi, my name is Dr. Athor. I'm one of the resident physicians working at Duke University Hospital System. I'll be giving you a talk on bacterial meningitis. The key learning objectives today will be to recognize the epidemiology and risk factors for bacterial meningitis, recognize the clinical presentation of bacterial meningitis, and learn how to evaluate, manage, and treat patients with bacterial meningitis. The outline is pretty similar to what I just discussed. We'll be talking about the epidemiology, risk factors, presentation, differential, which is important, and how to analyze the cerebral spinal fluid and what treatment strategies you should use. So first of all, bacterial meningitis, or meningitis in general, is an inflammatory disease of the leptomeninges, which is the tissue surrounding the brain and the spinal cord. It's an infection of the arachnoid matter in the cerebral spinal fluid and both the subarachnoid space and the cerebral ventricles. As far as epidemiology, strep pneumo and Neisseria meningitis accounts for about 80% of all cases in general. You'll see strep pneumonia more common in adults, and you'll see Neisseria meningitis more frequently in children or adolescents, though these are not hard and fast rules. You'll tend to see group B strep, listeria, and E. coli in infants less than 1 month of age, and you'll tend to see listeria as well in elderly or immunocompromised patients. And just a little side note, prior to the H influenza B vaccination, H influenza B actually accounted for 4 to 16% of all cases. And so just based on this, you know, trend with epidemiology, you can decide how you want to antibiose patients based on their age. As you can see in this next slide, you can risk stratify patients based on age, and you can surmise the most common pathogens based on age. So for patients less than 1 month of age, the most common pathogens, as I referred to prior, was strep pneumo, E. coli, listeria, and Klebsiella. For children or infants between 1 month and 23 months, you'll see strep pneumo, but you'll also start to see Neisseria, group B strep, H influenza, and E. coli. And then for toddlers, adolescents, and, you know, middle-aged adults, the most common pathogens are strep pneumo and Neisseria. And then for your elderly patients, you start to see strep pneumo, Neisseria, and Listeria, as well as aerobic gram-negative bacilli. Some of the risk factors for meningitis include age. You'll see it more commonly in the very old or the very young, though this is also not a hard and fast rule. You can also see in adolescents. Some other conditions that might predispose you to it are ENT conditions, patients with otitis, mastoiditis, sinusitis, they're at increased risk for spread to the meninges. Neurosurgical procedures, chronic disease, patients with diabetes who are immunocompromised. They are at increased risk for development of meningitis, patients who are alcoholics, and anyone who has risk factors for listeria. Those include your immunocompromised patients, your elderly, your young, and then patients who have ingested contaminated foods such as uncooked meats, vegetables, soft cheeses, cold cuts, unpasteurized milk. So typically meningitis, you know, there's a classic triad to meningitis. This includes fever, nuchal rigidity, altered mental status, such as confusion and lethargy. Curiously, the classic triad is only seen in about 50% of all cases. In general, headache is the most common symptom, and it's described as severe and a generalized headache. Generally, you will see fever. You may also see a seizure, focal deficits, rash, and petechiae. Petechiae, for those of you who don't know, are a maculopapular rash that's blanching, and you'll see that more common in meningococcal meningitis or meningitis caused by Neisseria meningitis. This is just a picture here of the petechiae that you would see associated with meningococcal meningitis. And this is in a child. So just to talk a little more about nuchal rigidity, what's meant by that is that you would have neck stiffness, you'll have pain and inability to passively flex or extend the head in a normal manner. Some of the things that you might test for in a patient are Brudzinski sign, and Kernig sign. Brudzinski sign is flexion of the neck causes flexion of the knees and hips. And Kernig sign is described by pain when you extend the knee with the hip flexed. And we have a picture here. So you can see right here with Kernig sign, with the patient supine, you flex the hip at 90 degrees and the knee cannot be fully extended because it causes pain to the inflamed meninges. And then on the bottom, you can see Brudzinski sign where passive flexion of the neck causes flexion of both the legs and the thighs, again, because of pain caused by the inflammation around the meninges. So when you see someone with severe headache, fever, altered mental status, there is a differential diagnosis in addition to meningitis that you should also be thinking about. Could this headache be due to a migraine? Could the focal deficits be due to a seizure? Was there a toxicologic ingestion or drug ingestion that's causing fever and altered mental status and perhaps headache? Other differentials include a metabolic derangement. Encephalitis is also in the differential. You might see that more in elderly patients. And then there could be, you know, any other infectious etiology, sepsis due to pneumonia or urosepsis, a urinary tract infection, might also cause sort of these vague symptoms of headache, fever, generalized fatigue. So the way you want to evaluate and manage a patient for which you have suspected meningitis is CSF analysis that will tell you whether or not the meninges are inflamed or infected and whether the cerebrospinal fluid is infected. So this is the way to analyze a cerebrospinal fluid or CSF is to do a lumbar puncture. Some people advocate doing a CAT scan prior to lumbar puncture. And the reason for that is that if you do lumbar puncture in someone and they have increased cerebral intracranial pressure, or they have a mass lesion, you could actually cause herniation when you insert the needle for the lumbar puncture. So some of the indications for getting a CAT scan of the brain prior to the lumbar puncture include altered mental status or altered level of consciousness, because that, like I said, could also be due to increased intracranial pressure due to some other cause like mass lesion. If a person has focal deficits, get a CAT scan prior to the lumbar puncture. Patients are immunocompromised. You might consider that these patients who are immunocompromised are at increased risk for mass lesions in the brain. History of any sort of CNS disease, such as mass lesions, astrocytomas, gliocytomas. New onset seizures are concerning for a mass lesion in the brain. If someone has a papilledema and you look at their retinas, that's concerning for increased cerebral or increased intracranial pressure, which would make you want to get a CT prior to the LP. And anyone who has a history or evidence of head traumas, these patients might have bleeding in the brain. And if you do an LP, you might cause herniation because of increased intracranial pressure that might be present as a result of the bleeding. However, if you have a high clinical suspicion for meningitis, this disease can be very fatal, and the performance of the lumbar puncture should not delay the administration of antibiotics because, as I mentioned, the disease can be very fatal. So if someone comes in, you have a high suspicion for meningitis, it's going to take you a while to get set up for the lumbar puncture. Just go ahead and get the antibiotics ready and just give them antibiotics because it can be fatal if you don't. So in general, the management algorithm for all bacterial meningitis. So if you have, you know, this is just a basic algorithm here. Do you suspect bacterial meningitis? If yes, you want to ask if there is a history of immunocompromise, CNS disease, new onset seizure, check for papilledema, altered level of consciousness, if there are focal deficits. And if they are present, then you want to do blood cultures. You want to do dexamethasone, which we'll talk about, and empiric antimicrobial therapy. Then you want to get a head CT and then afterwards perform a lumbar puncture. For patients that don't have any of these other comorbid conditions, you know, they don't have a new onset seizure, they don't have focal deficits, you can go ahead and do the blood cultures and lumbar puncture stat. You don't have to do the CAT scan beforehand. Afterwards, you could start dexamethasone therapy and empiric antibiotic therapy. And again, we will talk about what antibiotics to choose based on age and the need for dexamethasone. Afterwards, you can look at the CSF analysis from the lumbar puncture. If it's consistent with bacterial meningitis, then you want to get a Gram stain of that. And if that's consistent with bacterial meningitis, then you want to continue the antibiotic therapy. And if not, then you can discontinue it and look for another source of their altered mental status and fever. Some of the things that we're looking for in the CSF analysis for patients with bacterial meningitis, the three major things are glucose, protein, and cell count. For all patients, you also do want to send for a Gram stain. That doesn't come back usually right away, but these other things do. You're looking for a glucose of 0 to 45 milligrams per deciliter. Protein level is often elevated, greater than 250 milligrams per deciliter. And then the cell count is the most important because the glucose and the protein can be altered in other types of meningitis, such as viral or aseptic meningitis. So the cell count is usually elevated in bacterial meningitis. You'll see 100 to greater than 1,000 cells per microliter with an increased predominance of polymorphonucleocytes. And those are otherwise known as PMNs or neutrophils. So you'll see a neutrophilic predominance in the CSF analysis with the cell count. That's very concerning for meningitis. And then afterwards, as mentioned, don't forget to do the Gram stain because that will be very helpful later on in tailoring your antibiotics. As you can see here, this is just a slide that depicts, the differential for abnormal CSF findings. So for bacterial meningitis, you'll often see a glucose of less than 10 or 10 to 45. For bacterial meningitis, as I mentioned, you'll see the elevated protein count, greater than 250, and then the white blood cell count, most telling is for greater than 1,000. That's most suggestive of bacterial meningitis. A white blood cell count of 100 to 1,000 can also suggest that, but if it's less than that, you want to think of other things such as aseptic meningitis, TB meningitis, perhaps early bacterial meningitis. And then on the bottom of the table, you just have some other things that might cause altered CSF or might cause abnormal CSF findings. And those are on the differential diagnosis for bacterial meningitis, but we won't be discussing that here. So for empiric antibiotics for these patients, if you're suspicious of bacterial meningitis, you want to start this right away. As I mentioned before, you want to risk stratify based on age because that you can kind of surmise what pathogens are most common based on age. So for adults, you want to cover for Neisseria meningitides and strep pneumo. You would choose a third generation cephalosporin such as ceftriaxone, and you would use a meningitic dose. Generally, ceftriaxone for all other infections, we use 1 gram. However, to allow ceftriaxone to cover the blood-brain barrier, you want to do a higher dose for CSF penetration, and that would be 2 grams to cover Neisseria meningitides. You also want to add vancomycin to cover for drug-resistant strep pneumo. For patients greater than 50 years old, you want to add ampicillin to cover for listeria, H. influenza, and aerobic gram-negative bacilli. And as mentioned, it's because these patients greater than 50 years old are more immunocompromised and more likely to have meningitis from these other pathogens in addition to the ones I just mentioned. And then for the patients, the younger patients who are less than a month old, these patients are more at risk for group B strep, Klebsiella, E. coli, and listeria. Just one thing you want to ask for, your patients that come in less than 1 month who you're suspicious for meningitis, you want to ask the mom whether she was positive for group B strep in the peripartum period. That might be helpful. If she is, then you definitely want to cover for group B strep. So for these patients, you would do ampicillin plus cefotaxime to cover these pathogens or ampicillin and aminoglycoside. So this is just another table that demonstrates the recommendations for empiric antibiotic therapy based on age and the specific pathogen that might be present based on age. We kind of discussed the pathogens that are present based on age, and we already talked about what antibiotics you would use. So you might want to just take a look at this table one more time and make sure you're familiar with it. Some of the other things you want to think about is if there's head trauma, then you might want to cover for different pathogens or different pathogens might be present. It might not necessarily change what antibiotics you might use, but it's good to think about what other bugs might be present. For example, for a basilar skull fracture, you might have H influenza, group A beta hemolytic strep, and in addition to strep pneumonia. And then for penetrating trauma, you might see Staph aureus, and that's just because Staph aureus is a very common skin flora. And if you have penetrating trauma, you probably infected your meninges with that. In addition to Staph aureus, you might see coag-negative Staph and aerobic gram-negative bacilli, including pseudomonas. So for those patients, you might want to do vanc plus cefepime, or vanc and ceftazidime, or vanc and meropenem. For patients who had a neurosurgical procedure, they're at risk for aerobic gram-negative bacilli infection with that, including pseudomonas. They're also, because of, like I mentioned, Staph and some of the skin flora, are more likely to infect the meninges during a neurosurgical procedure. You also want to make sure you're covering for Staph aureus, coag-negative Staph. So you would also do a similar antibiotic regimen as the prior one that I just mentioned, vanc plus cefepime, or vanc plus ceftazidime, or vanc plus meropenem. For patients who are immunocompromised, they are more at risk for, as I mentioned on the previous slide, listeria, aerobic gram-negative bacilli, including pseudomonas, in addition to the other pathogens that present for all adults in general, which is strep pneumonia and Neisseria. So for them, you want to add ampicillin in addition to the vanc and cefepime, or the vanc and ceftriaxone. There's a discussion about steroids and bacterial meningitis. In general, it's recommended that you administer adjunctive dexamethasone either just prior to the first dose of antibiotics or with the first dose of antibiotics. It's thought to reduce the neurologic sequelae of meningitis, such as decreased hearing, which is the most common sequelae of bacterial meningitis. And the reason why this is thought to work is that it likely attenuates the inflammatory response that occurs with bacterial cell lysis once the antibiotics are administered. And if there's less inflammatory response to that cell lysis, you might have less damage to your neurons and hopefully less sequelae. Just a summary, the causative pathogens of meningitis vary by age and by clinical presentation. If someone's had a neurosurgical procedure or head trauma, you want to make sure that you're covering for the appropriate pathogens. The classic triad of fever, nuchal rigidity, and altered mental status is only present in about 50% of patients, so don't rely on that alone to make your decision of covering for bacterial meningitis. Have a low threshold for starting antibiotics if there's any clinical suspicion for bacterial meningitis, just because this is a very fatal disease if you delay treatment. And as mentioned above, antibiotic selection does vary on age. And then also, you want to give steroids prior to antibiotic use to decrease the inflammation that might occur with bacterial cell lysis and to decrease any neurologic sequelae.